tell you a little bit about myself so you can start to maybe think, you know, as you're thinking about China, hopefully what I can do today is to help you to make some sense out of what you've been seeing over the last couple of days and what you're going to see in your remaining time here. I grew up in a place called Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, and then I went on to Yale University, where among, you know, what I did in the classroom, I also played in one of the best Yale football teams of all time. I then went to Harvard Business School, and then graduated in 1973, so that you can calculate how old I might be. I then went to work for a company called Payne Weber on Wall Street, and Payne Weber is now part of UBS. And I went into the investment banking business, and I spent literally the next 20 years in investment banking, and I did just about every type of transaction you could imagine. I did private placements, I did mergers and acquisitions, I took companies public, I ran a real estate group, and then my last job at Payne Weber was running the investment banking department. And so you might say that I had the first 20 years of my working career was spent on Wall Street, and I had, you know, most people consider a pretty decent career. But in 1990, I decided that as great, you know, as good as all that was, it kind of wasn't enough. I got in my head what I wanted to do was I wanted to identify a trend and then do something to get out ahead of that trend. And it really could have been anything. It could have been any industry, any part of the world. It really didn't make any difference. There was only one qualification. It had to be a long-term trend. Because what I told myself was whatever it is I'm going to do it for the rest of my working career, which I hope will be a long time. And that started, you know, getting me interested in Asia. Now, why Asia? Well, as I kind of started to understand what was happening, there was a very basic fundamental demographic fact, which is that about half the world's population lives in Asia, and the average age is in the low 20s. Now, the reason why that's important is because young populations spend money. They fall in love, they get married, they have children, they buy houses, they buy cars. So if you want to understand why Asian economies, including China, are growing so quickly, it's because they have very large young populations that are spending money. So as I understood that, I said, oh, okay, this is kind of the long-term trend that I've been looking for. Because if that's true, then what that meant was that for the, you know, the 21st century, it was going to be the story of the development of Asia. So I then got in my head that, you know, this could be that long-term trend and there was an opportunity. And so, you know, I then had to think about how am I going to fit into that picture. And I thought to myself that if that was true, then obviously companies that were based in Asia were going to have great growth prospects. But in order to take advantage of those, they were going to have to get access to the ingredients of capital management and technology. And because I just spent 20 years on Wall Street gathering those resources from many different types of companies, I felt that I could help them to do that. So from 100,000 foot level, I said, okay, I'll go and I'll help companies in Asia get access to capital management and technology. And I knew that, you know, I thought that was a pretty good overall strategy. But I knew that in order to implement it, it would mean me moving from the United States to Asia, because I didn't really think, as nice as it would have been, I didn't really think I could execute a strategy like that from New York or my farm in New Jersey. And so part and parcel of the business decision was also a personal lifestyle decision. And so I became very excited. And as I went around, you know, I then started networking with all the people I'd met from business school and from Wall Street and so forth, and tell about my grand plan for the rest of my life. And as I would sit there and have these meetings in the fall of 1990 and explain all this, people would nod and they'd say, Jack, we agree with you. Asia is the story of the 21st century. And then at some point during the discussion, they kind of look at me and they say, of course, you've been there many times, right? And I said, no, I've never been there. And that was the honest to God's truth. When I kind of made the decision to really look at this seriously, I'd never stepped foot in this part of Asia. I will confess that I've been to Japan, because one of the last things I did at Payne Weber was I raised $350 million for Payne Weber from a company called Yasuda Life. I had to negotiate the deal twice. I did it once before Black Monday, October 19th, 1987. Then I had to renegotiate it afterwards, but getting that money was very, very important to paying wherever at that time, even more important after Black Monday. But in any event, I'd been to Japan a number of times. You know, but what we're talking about, Japan is not Southeast Asia, not China. Japan's more U.S., Western Europe, highly developed economy and country. So I made my first trip to Asia in the fall of 1990. I ended up spending about 6 weeks, mostly in Hong Kong. I went to Taiwan, went to Korea for a couple days, and then on the way back, I stopped to see my friends at Yasuda Life in Japan. And so to kind of sum it all up, when I made that first trip, what I saw happening on the ground really was confirming everything that I'd been reading. So I became very encouraged. And I made a whole series of trips to Asia through 1991. And then at the end of 91, just picked up and moved to Hong Kong. And, you know, if you've ever been to Hong Kong, the business area is called Central. And in Central, there's a building called Admiralty. And in Admiralty, there was a business center. And in that business center, you could rent an office for a day, a week, or a month. And if you paid them enough money, when your phone rang, they would answer with the name of the company you gave them. So when your friends called from Israel or the States or wherever, they'd think you were running this big business in Asia, when in fact all you had was this little office. And so I'm sure I was thinking long term at the time, so I took an office for a month. And as I sat down at my desk, the first question I had to answer is, where am I going to focus? See, because like most Americans who kind of grew up and did business in this pre-globalization era, you never really had to leave the United States. And so for most Americans, they don't really have an appreciation for Asia. Asia is just sort of one big region. But all of a sudden, when you're in Hong Kong, in the middle of Asia, you realize it's a big region with a lot of different countries, all with different governments, different ways of doing business, and so forth. And unless you're going to try to make yourself an expert on each one of them, you need to pick one or two to specialize in. Well, see, today it's easy, it's China. But back then, you know, that wasn't so clear. In fact, most people that looked like me weren't even going anywhere near China. It was way, way, way too early. So in order to help figure that out, you know, one of the guys that we had done some financing for is a fellow named Tong Chi-Wa, whose family has a big shipping company in Hong Kong. And we raised some capital for a shipping company. And I got to know him a little bit. And when he heard I was thinking of coming to Hong Kong, he actually called me up one time when he was in New York and said, you know, we'll have dinner. And you know, CH went on to become the first chief administrator for Hong Kong when it reverted to China in 1997. He's a pretty well-placed guy, kind of, you know, well-known in China and around the region. And he basically thought it was great that I was thinking of coming to Hong Kong. And he said, Jack, he said, if you come, he said, whatever I can do to help, I will. So as I sat down at my desk in Admiralty, the first person I called was CH. And what he did is he introduced me to a lot of his overseas Chinese businessmen friends, people who were running big companies in Hong Kong, Taiwan, so forth. And as I talked to each one of them, what struck me is every one of the discussions went the same way. They would spend 5 minutes talking about their very big business in Hong Kong and 25 talking about China. So I'm a pretty simple person. I figure if the smartest, most knowledgeable people in the region are going to China, then why should I do a lot of research? So that's how I made the decision to go to China. And I made my first trip to China in September of 1992. I can honestly tell you, I knew absolutely nothing about this country. I was an American studies major at Yale, not a Chinese studies major. I didn't know a soul in the country. I didn't speak the language then. I don't speak it now. I can honestly tell you, I'll never speak Chinese. I'm from Pittsburgh. Most people don't think the English I speak qualifies as a language. So you might be sitting and saying, wow, scratching your head, saying, well, Jack, how in the world can you come to this big, mysterious, complicated country, not knowing anybody, you know, not knowing anything about the country, and you know, not even able to talk to anybody? How can you make some sense of it? Well, after 20 years of being here, I've managed to convince myself that the best way to come to China is as a blank sheet of paper, like many of you are at this point, this is your first trip here. And the reason for that is China changes so quickly. See, when I took my first plane flight from Pittsburgh to New York City when I was 17 years old, the first thing I knew when I landed in New York is everybody in New York walked faster and talked faster than the people in Pittsburgh. When I came to China, everybody's running. this place is on steroids. It literally changes before your very eyes. And not just physically, but just in what's happening, developments and so forth. Things just happen very, very, very quickly here. So in that context, what happened 10 years ago in China is important. But that's not nearly as important as what happened a year ago. And that's not nearly as important as what's happening today right before your very eyes. So when people or companies ask me how to make some sense of China, I say, talk to all the experts. But never let that substitute for your own personal investigation. Come here, absorb it, take it in, kind of factor it into, you know, all of your other experiences and your knowledge. And you'd be surprised how you can start to pick up the little pieces of logic to kind of pull the country together. What I'll try to do today is to tell you about some of the things that I've learned over the years that at least have helped me to understand or make some sense out of what's happening in China, and that may help you as well. The first thing that I noticed when I came to China, it's a big country. Now, it may seem obvious to all of you, but I knew there were a lot of people, but frankly, I didn't realize that almost to the square kilometer, China's the same size as the United States. And that had some very important implications. It meant, for example, that every industry was replicated in every, it was fragmented, every industry was fragmented because it was replicated in every major city and province throughout the country. It also meant that companies were doing business locally rather than nationally. So in kind of thinking about, you know, how the United States developed, it became pretty clear to me that as the, you know, the country developed and as the telecommunications and transportation infrastructure improved, that that was going to change. That industries were going to start to consolidate, and companies that were doing business locally would now start doing business nationally. So in that context, I thought, well, for me, rather than picking individual companies to invest in, what I should do is pick an industry and develop a strategy for creating a leading company in that industry. So for me, the first takeaway was, you know, pick an industry and then develop a company. Now, I picked automotive, and I'll tell you a little bit about the company that I founded and been built for 15 years. But when people understand that I picked automotive, they say, Jack, of all the industries you could have picked, why automotive? That's a tough, tough, tough industry, and it's true. And this is where, you know, for the moment at least, you have to kind of, when you're kind of trying to understand China, you need to take all the things you've learned over the last 20, 30 years of your life and just leave it at the border for a little bit. And just absorb and then start to pull pieces of information. Because what I don't want you to do is to come here with a lot of preconceived notions. So if you grow up in the United States and you're kind of operating in the auto industry, God, you'd never want to go in the auto industry because it's a saturated, very mature industry in the U.S. But see, in China, that could be, in a developing country, could be a whole different story. So for example, when I started looking at the automotive industry, China was making about 500,000 to a million vehicles a year. It was, you know, pretty interesting, but wasn't getting anybody terribly excited. You know, Volkswagen already set up joint ventures. People were kind of slow coming in. And, you know, people saying, it's sort of an interesting market. Someday it may develop, but, you know, we're holding off for now. But to me, I saw a couple things happening. One, I felt that if it was true that China was going to continue to grow, and at any given point in time, there's two sets of people. There are people that think that China's going to go off the rails. This is not sustainable. And they have, you know, depending on what year it is, they've got their own explanation for why. And then there are people that believe, like myself, that have confidence that while it's not going to be a straight line, it's going to, you know, it's going to kind of be heading in this direction. I came to that very early conclusion that China was on the right track. And, you know, while it's going to certainly have its challenges, this was going to be a long-term growth story. So if you were in that camp, then it was absolutely, it was like day follows night. It was very clear that China had to have a large auto industry. I mean, how in the world do you move people and goods around a rapidly growing economy without highways, trucks, buses, and passenger cars? And a lot of them. Well, last year, China did 18 million vehicles. The United States did 12. China's by far now, by far, the largest vehicle market in the world. 2015, they'll do 25. 2020, the estimates are 30 to 40 million vehicles a year. Now, to put it in context, there are about 75 million vehicles a year made in the whole world. So in 5 or 6 short years, China will be accounting for 35-40% of the global vehicle production and consumption, okay? So that's why you kind of need to take into account the fact that China's at a different place from an economic development point of view. So as I got, you know, start to understand all that, I got very excited about the auto industry. And I also got excited because, you know, companies like Volkswagen were coming in, but they had a very difficult time convincing their traditional suppliers to come to China. Because for most of them, it was too early. And so that meant that there was a vacuum. And everybody was frustrated because everybody knew you couldn't build good cars, couldn't build good trucks without a viable components industry. So China, in 1994, passed a policy which basically said that foreign investors in components could have majority ownership. Now, today there are a lot of businesses, a lot of industries, you can own 100%, you can own majority. But back then, this was one of the only ones. And to me, that was important. That was kind of the final straw. And the reason it was important is because the other thing I saw is that every year went by, China was getting more and more integrated into the global economy. So that meant it wasn't enough to build a good company in China. We had to build a company that would be globally competitive. And so that meant that whatever I found on the ground, in terms of people or companies, they were going to have to change. And I had to have the ability to basically to implement those changes. So in the at the end of 91, beginning of 92, I decided to set out and build a major automotive components in China. I was very excited about the industry. There was a vacuum because the traditional players around the world weren't coming, and the government said that I could have majority. And I then went and recruited two people. I recruited a British accountant who spoke Chinese, and I recruited a Chinese national. And so at the beginning of 1992, Simco was the three of us. Simco Technologies, the company I built, was the three of us plus my American Express card. Mm-hmm. When I was a second year student at Harvard, to every second year student, there's a small bank called Coolidge Bank and Trust. And they would send this card free because they wanted to drum up business. So I've been a platinum card member since 1973. I'll let the law professor look at it and verify it, okay? So I've been a platinum card member since 1973. I never realized how powerful this card is until when I was in Beijing. My oldest daughter just left. She was here with her three lovely young children. And she's a very, very responsible mother. She's great. But I'll tell you, when she was in high school, she couldn't balance her checkbook to save her life. So at the end of high school, she, like a lot of graduating students, wanted to go with a friend and backpack and Eurorail around Europe and so forth. And of course, I resisted because I knew where this might lead. But she's very headstrong, and she finally went ahead and she did it. So I'm sitting in my office that summer in Beijing, and I get a call from Sarah. He says, "Dad, I got a problem." I said, "What's the matter, honey?" He said, "I'm out of money." I said, "Well, where are you?" "I'm in Rome." I said, "Okay, just calm down." I said, "I'm sure there's an American Express office there. I'm going to call and I'm going to authorize a card for you. You go there tomorrow morning and pick it up." She says, "Oh, thank you, Dad." So she hangs up. I call American Express, authorize the card. My wife, Carlene's in the next office. She's head of corporate communications for Simco at that time. And she hears all these phone calls and all this kind of stuff. And she kind of walks in and she says, what was that all about? And I was very proud of myself because I handled it all myself without getting her involved. And she says, Sarah called, she's had a problem. No, but don't worry, I took care of it. I authorized an American Express card." She said, "You did what?" She said, "Do you realize that has unlimited charging privileges?" I said, my jaw dropped, and I said, "No, I didn't quite realize. It was like giving a weapon to somebody who shouldn't have one." So I knew I was in big trouble the next morning when Sarah calls. And you know how daughters are. She said, "Dad, thank you so much. Do you realize I can buy a car with this?" And that's when the rest of the summer I was worried about what kind of car she was going to buy in Italy and ship back to our farm in New Jersey. Anyway, I'm glad this had unlimited charging privileges because the three of us, in the first 9 months of 1993, visited over 100 factories in 40 cities all over China. You name the city or province, we were there. During that 9 months, I ate every part of every animal, with the emphasis on every. And during that 9 months, I drank more baijiu. It's a white liquor that hopefully you had a chance to taste. I drank more baijiu during that 9 months than any human being should ever drink in a lifetime. At the end of that 9 months, I figured I better go back and get some real capital before my liver goes out. So I went back to my colleagues on Wall Street And 6 weeks over the Christmas holidays raised over $100 million to found a company called Simco Technologies. And I came back to China in February of 1994, and we set up a Simco. And for the next 15 years, until 2009, I basically built that company brick by brick and ran it as the CEO. And essentially, Simco today is about a $500 million company. It's got about 12,000 employees, a dozen factories in 8 different provinces all over China. One of the leading players in the commercial vehicle business. If you see a truck or a bus running around China, it's running on a diesel engine. Chances are that up to 20 to 25% of the parts for that diesel engine could come from the Simco factory. Simco does blocks and heads, piston rings, camshafts, fuel systems, starts and alternators, compressors, all of the key components that go into that diesel engine. The two things I'm proudest about is the fact that, first of all, we kind of pioneered the development of local management. And so by the time, after I got into it and sort of understood what was going on and started to figure things out, basically we went to a policy of really having all of our factories were run by mainland Chinese. And I say mainland, I mean mainland. People that grew up here, worked here, went to school here, understand China. And so, we kind of gained a reputation for really developing very good local management. In fact, we were twice named one of the 10 best employers in China, and these were surveys done by the Wall Street Journal, Hewitt Associates, and so forth. The second time we were named it, we were the only manufacturing company on the list. The rest were all service companies. The second thing I'm proudest about is the fact that we learned how to sell to the local market. And I'm going to explain what that means in a minute. But we became a Chinese company. In fact, in 2008, China Auto News named me one of the 30 outstanding entrepreneurs in China's auto industry, not just for 1 year, but for the whole 30 years of economic reform. I was the only foreigner on that list. The other 29 were all Chinese entrepreneurs, Chinese businessmen who had built other large automotive businesses. And I tell you that not to impress you, but I hope you're impressed. But I tell you that because what that told me is the local media, the industry here, viewed a Simco, even though we were funded with outside capital, they viewed us as a Chinese company. So what I tell companies when they're trying to figure out China is that what you need to do ultimately is you need to make your business a Chinese business in China. And that starts with management and developing and empowering a local management team. Now, when I say that, most people naturally assume that the reason I say that is because of the language, the culture, right? I mean, if you're going to operate here, you need to be able to speak the language, you need to understand the culture. And certainly language and culture are two very important reasons to have local managers. But believe it or not, they're not the most important. The most important is that the Chinese have a fundamentally different and lower cost perspective than I do. Anybody from the United States, and I would venture to say everybody in this room. And let me illustrate what that means. One of the products that Simco makes are piston rings. Just happen to have a few with me. Simco also makes blocks and heads, but they're too heavy. These fit in my pocket. Simco makes about 140 million of these a year, which makes Simco certainly one of the largest in China, but it also makes it one of the largest in the world. We make them in a small city called Yijing. I think you just came from Nanjing. You were about an hour and a half from Yijing, okay? We used to always fly to Nanjing and then drive to Yijing. We're making this small city in Jiangsu province called Yijing. It's about 500,000-600,000 people. That's a small city in China. And I wrote a book, along the way when I was doing all this, I met Tom Friedman. And Tom was writing The World is Flat, and he wanted to understand how China fit into all that. And if you read The World is Flat, a big part of the chapter about China is about me and the Simco. But, among other things, he encouraged me to write a book. So a book called Managing the Dragon came out in March of 2008. In May of 2008, the Chinese edition came out. Originally, this was $24. This was 24 yuan. Plus, you get my picture. Okay. There's a story in that, too. But you can still get it on Amazon, and I encourage you, if you're interested, to buy. I'm biased, but I think it's the best book in China. Anyway. if you read the book, the first part of it talks about these trips to these 100 factories in all these different parts China. And we were going to some of a lot of these mountain factories, these Mao Third Front factories. And in many places, we were the only foreigners that had ever been there. And most of those places, the places we stayed in were god-awful. I mean, if you put a one-star next to them, you'd be exaggerating. So I was very happy when I did our joint venture in Ijeon, that when a couple years later, when a local developer put up this nice 20-story hotel. It's not the Ritz, not the Four Seasons, but it's nice. It meant when I went to Ijeon, I had a nice place to stay. So a couple years after it was built, I took an American friend of mine to Ijeon to see our pistoner business. And we stayed in that hotel. And as I'm coming down the elevator to check out the next morning, I see my friend at the checkout counter, and he's getting his bill. And he has it in front of him, 240 RMB. And as I walk up to him, he did what every American does when they come to China. And frankly, what I still do after being here for 20 years. He divided by 8. Now that's the historical exchange rate between, well, for most of my time here, between the yuan and the dollar. Now it's 6.5, but that back then it was 8. So he divides by 8 and he turns to me. And he said, Jack, he said, now I understand why the overhead costs in China are so low. $30 for this hotel room. What a bargain. I didn't say anything to him, but it was one of those moments when the penny dropped for me. Because I thought, you know, by that time we had localized all of our management. And I thought to myself, if any one of my Chinese managers went to Ijeon, they wouldn't stay there. They'd think it was too expensive. They'd look for hotels 150 RMB. And if two of them were traveling together, they'd basically double up and split the cost. So here my American friend saw 240 RMB. And what he really saw was $30. And he concluded that was cheap. My Chinese managers looked at the same 240 RMB, and they see something much different. And they conclude that's way too expensive. That's what I mean by the fundamentally different way of looking at exactly the same product. So ever since that day, I carry around with me two bills. One's 100 RMB with Chairman Mao, and one's 100 US with Benjamin Franklin. And what I tell people is these two bills are treated exactly the same way in their respective countries. You can't get a bill larger than 100 in the US. You can't get a bill larger than 100 in China. If I go to the supermarket near my farm in New Jersey and pay with this, they'll put under light to see if it's counterfeit. If I go to the shopping center across the street from my apartment here in Beijing and pay with this, they'll feel it, look at the serial number, and to see if it's counterfeit. And if you look at them, Chairman Mao even looks a little bit like Benjamin Franklin. So the point I make to people is that when an American comes to China and they see 100 RMB, what they really see is something more like $12.50 today. They see something more like $15. But when a Chinese, and I don't care how wealthy they are, by the way, I know you've seen a lot of wealth, displays of wealth here. I don't care how wealthy they are. When the Chinese looks at this, they see something that looks more like this. Fundamentally different way of looking at exactly the same physical object. Now you might be saying, well, that's kind of interesting, Jack. I never really thought of that before, but you know, what does that have to do with anything? Well, you know, take a US company and a Chinese company. They both make the same products, and they're both going to build a factory in the same city in China making that product. The US company gets their facility planner, Joe Smith, to oversee construction. The Chinese company gets their Mr. Joe, and his name is spelled Z-H-O-U, and he's going to oversee construction. First input's 100 RMB. Joe Smith looks at it, divides by 8, says, well, $12.50, that's 30% cheaper I can get in the United States, buy it. Mr. Joe, Z-H-O-U, Joe, looks at that same 100 RMB, sees something more like this, it's too expensive, negotiates it down by 30%. So here you have two factories in the same city in China making exactly the same product. And right from the get-go, before you get to all the other inputs in production, you basically have one factory is lower cost than the other. Now the only thing that you know, may make that equation work for a while is the fact there may be a quality and or technology difference between the products. But keep in mind what I said about China changing. Those gaps are now closing very, very rapidly. So basically, if you're a company that comes into China, US, European, Israel, it doesn't make a difference where you're from. And if you don't localize your management, and if you don't have local managers, Chinese managers, making those key purchasing and other kinds of decisions, What you end up doing is importing into China a higher cost perspective. And so you may build a factory in China that's lower cost than your factory back home, but it's high cost in China. So to me, that's the most important reason to have local managers, because they understand how to, basically understand how to keep those costs low. They also understand at what price point your product may be able to sell in the marketplace. So the argument I use is, if you want to have long-term success in China, then your managers here, the people making decisions, have to have the same cost perspective as their customers and their competitors. Okay, now when you put that together with the way China has developed, it really creates a situation where China is now probably the largest market for most any product. But the way the economy's developed and so forth, it's operating very differently than other large economies around the world. It's very important to understand that. So if you look at China from 1988 to 2008, and if you want to look at the market for any product and how that's changed over time, and if you look at those products in terms of two factors, one is price, one is technology, with high being up here and low being down there. And if I asked you, what did China's market look like for any product in 1988? Well, you say, well, Jack, give me a little information. Okay. In 1988, China had $300 billion GDP, a billion people, $300 per capita income. At that point, there were some joint ventures done, but most of the production in China was done by local companies. And frankly, most of the consumption was done by either local companies or local individuals. So I wasn't here then, but I would argue that the market for any product doesn't make any difference. In 1988, looked something like this. Completely local market at the low end of the price technology scale. Why? Per capita income is only $300. People couldn't afford anything else. Okay. Now, if you fast forward to 2008, China's a $4.4 trillion economy, a billion three people, and per capita income is $3,200. What's the market look like for any product? Well, the first thing that happened is local market just got a lot bigger. The reason is because the economy grew by more than tenfold. Who shops there? Well, there are about 900 million people whose average per capita income is $800. They shop there. They're much better off than they were in 1988, but I think you'd even admit that you can't do much with $900 in terms of really expensive goods and services and so forth. So you know, if you do the math, you can see that 400 million people are missing. And what they did is they essentially created a second market. And those people, about 400 million, they're making about 9,000 per year. Okay? And so they created what I call a foreign local market. Why do I call it a foreign local market? Well, because when companies from outside China come to China, this is where they compete. Because this is the market that looks most like what they have at home. Same kind of price levels, same kind of technology levels. And they compete in this market against every one of their international competitors. Everybody's here. Plus the best of the Chinese companies. Okay? So they come to this market, and so they focus on the high price side. They never really think about this. Because when they look down there and they see the products that are being made, the prices, the quality, they say, no, that's not what we do. So they really confine themselves to this market. Let me just show you how it works. I told you could do it for any product. Since I just spent 15, 20 years in the auto industry, let me just explain how it works for autos. And I guarantee you, I don't care whoever you work for, whatever your products are, you tell me the product, give my staff a day or two, and we'll figure out. We'll tell you exactly how it works for your product. It'll be the same. It'll be the same thing. I told you that China made 18 million vehicles last year, right? And that was the biggest market by far in the world for vehicles. Well, believe it or not, that's just the tip of the iceberg. Because every year China makes 60 million gasoline and diesel engines for transportation. So that means the local market for transportation is actually much bigger at $32 million. Now, what's in that local market? Well, they're motorcycles, they're agricultural vehicles. If you went out to the Great Wall, you probably saw these little contraptions where the Chinese take a one-cylinder diesel engine, hook it up to a chassis. They call them minkfish because they spew off so much black smoke. They make this up because obviously the people here can't afford those cars that are being made by the foreign joint ventures here, right? Now, why? Now you might be sitting and saying, wait a minute, how can you compare a motorcycle, an agricultural vehicle, or that inkfish to the shiny new Buick I bought from Shanghai GM? Well, there are two reasons. One is every one of those vehicles serve exactly the same function. They move people and goods around this country. The second is every one of them needs piston rings. So if you're making piston rings, you better be thinking about this much, much bigger market, okay? So those are the two reasons. Now, if you take that and combine it with, you know, what we learned here, there are five conclusions you can draw about the China market. As big as you thought it is, it's actually bigger. See, if somebody from Detroit tries to tell you that China's vehicle market's 18 million, say, no, I heard this guy in Beijing, it's already 60. Which, believe me, it's 60. Two, it's fast growing. Tenfold growth, 20 years. I mean, very hard to pick something here that isn't, you have to really try hard to pick something here that isn't growing very quickly. Three, I would argue that China is the most competitive market in the world. You're competing against every major international company that's trying to get a piece of this market, plus the best of the local companies. Let me give you an example. About 6-7 years ago, we did a study, and we concluded that our company plus two or three largest competitors accounted for about 2/3 of the piston ring market in China. Guess how many piston ring companies there were in China then? I'll give you a hint. There are about 6 around the world. Any guesses?
180.
Now you're all taking MBA courses, you know. So yeah, you know, that's, this industry's got to consolidate. China doesn't need 180 piston ring companies. 5 years later, 6 years later, guess how many there are today? 400. Going the other way. Every industry is the same way. If you take a product with any level of technology, see what's happened, piston rings, you know, these look very simple, but they're actually very critical to emission control, okay? So as the emission standards have evolved over the last 20, 30 years, there might have been 20 piston ring companies years ago in the globe, right? But some of them couldn't keep up with the technology, the quality. And so some of them went by the wayside, went bankrupt, got sold, and so forth. So it got narrowed down to about 6. With any product, with any technology, basically that's what's happening. So if you, you know, think about some of the, you know, products around the world, you look around, there are probably 6, maybe a dozen companies globally that are left making those products. You come to China, and you have 200, 300, 400, 1,000 companies making the same products or something that performs the same function. Remember I told you that China's kind of developing a lot differently? Well, this is one of the areas. Because, and the reason why, for example, the piston ring business went from 180 to 400, is see, because this local market, you know, back 5 years ago, maybe this number, 60 million, was 40 million, right? So another 20 million, some of them were in the high end, but there were a lot more agricultural vehicles and so forth. And so, basically, local production had to expand. And, you know, the one thing about China, see, in the United States, Europe, other developed economies of the world, if you fall behind even a little bit in quality or technology, you kind of go by the wayside. In China, no matter how, you know, bad your quality is, no matter how low level of technology is, you can sell your product somewhere in China if it's cheap enough. So basically what this means is that companies would have otherwise gone out of business, kind of lived to fight another day. And in this growing local market, they're competing against companies that are similarly situated, that have the same disadvantages they have, but also the same advantages. And then they get bigger because this market's getting bigger. And then over time, some of them, not all of them, start to improve their quality and technology. And guess where they start heading? Once they get a little bit better in quality and technology, they start heading up here. And they join the ranks up at this end. Once they're here, guess where they're headed? Overseas. I've never met one Chinese CEO that doesn't have an ambition to be global. China's not big enough. They want to go global. They want to be a global company.
I'll give you an example of this very phenomenon, Geely. Have you heard of it? In 1997, it's a local Chinese car company. In 1997, they made $100 motorcycles for this market. Their chairman, Li Shufu, announced that he wanted to get into passenger car business. Everybody in the world, including most people in China, thought that was the funniest thing they'd ever heard. How could this countryside manufacturer of $100 motorcycles compete with the likes of Volkswagen, GM, and so forth? Well, guess what? He's now got about 6% of the market in China. And last year, he bought Volvo. Okay. The same pattern you're going to see happen over and over and over again in industry after industry. If you look at all the industries, basically the market share of the local companies is steadily, year by year, quarter by quarter, increasing vis-a-vis the foreign companies because of that fundamental difference we talked about on the cost perspective. The fourth is that it's very price competitive. See, the 400 million people up here can probably afford that notebook computer you have. But frankly, they prefer not to pay what you pay for it. Because when they look at 100 RMB, they see 100 US. They'd rather get it cheaper. The 900 million people down here would like that computer. They just can't afford it. They understand the power of the internet. So every day, 1.3 billion Chinese wake up and think about how to make their all their products cheaper, more affordable, easier to use. And then I would argue that that basically leads to innovation. Because what China has to do is China needs to develop its economy, needs to figure out how to solve its pollution problem. It needs to solve how it needs to figure out how to get power to all the people in China, all the, you know, that want to use vehicles, to do all the things that people in the United States and other developed countries around the world do, but it has to do it in a different way because there aren't enough resources on the planet to do that. And it has to do it in a way that essentially fits with this lower cost perspective. And I would argue this leads to innovation. So what I see happening in China is not only this market getting bigger, the companies are getting bigger, the local companies. They're getting better against their foreign competition. And then the last piece is they're getting better capitalized. And that's kind of what leads me to what I did in 2009. Basically, and let me just take 2 minutes and just talk about what I'm doing now, and then we can open up for questions. But I basically, as I saw all this happening, I decided that as fun as Simca was, I really wanted to go on and do something that combined the 20 years I spent on Wall Street plus the 20 years I've now spent in China. And so I left all my management positions. Simca was sold to Bain Capital last year. In April of 2009, I opened up a company called JFB Holdings. We're doing really three things. The first thing we're doing is we're helping international companies as they come to China to basically help them to figure out their strategy, and then, as importantly, to help them to implement that strategy. And the people I have now, many of them work for me at Simca for 10 years. These are all proven people that know how to manage factories, run sales forces, and so forth. And that's kind of a strategic advisory business, if you want to call it that. And we're working with all types of companies from all parts of the world, all sizes, all different industries. The second thing we do is we're helping a subset of them raise capital in China. The biggest difference between 1994 and today is the fact that China is now developing into a capital source. And that's going to be the story of the next 10 years. As excited I was about the auto components business in 1994, I'm even more excited about this one because I saw this happen once before. It happened in the 1970s and 1980s on Wall Street in the United States. 1970s, you couldn't give away a public offering. I was an investment banker in 1973 to 1980. During that period, the Dow went from, I think, 858 to 835. Very difficult for companies of almost any size to raise capital. That was the same thing I saw in China. China was in the same place in 1994. However, in the 1980s, the United States, the Dow Jones tripled. When I was running investment banking, we were taking companies like Genentech public and so forth. Venture capital thrived. Michael Milken invented junk bonds, the LBO business. The now private equity firms all started then as LBO firms. So in terms of capital markets, the United States in the 1980s looked 180 degrees different from the 1970s, and that's what's happening in China. When I first came here in 94, it was like the US in the 70s. Today, I can just see it happening. The same kind of things are happening. You now had 330 companies last year went public on China's A-share market in Shenzhen. These were all small, medium-sized enterprises, growth companies, technology companies,
and so forth. Venture capital is thriving here, local private equity firms, you name them. You just go down the list. I do a blog called managingthedragon.com. I just did one on China's changing capital markets. I'd urge you to go back and take a look at that. It'll outline all the changes. So we're working with a group of companies from overseas that want to come to China, but for a variety of reasons, they're capital constrained at home. And we basically can help them get capital here in China. The third thing we're doing is we're helping Chinese companies to go abroad. We're helping them to make acquisitions, get the capital, you know, whatever it is. So anyway, that's kind of what we're doing. Very excited about this place. People ask me how long I'm going to stay here. As long as they'll have me. you know, I got my farm in New Jersey. I love that. But my wife and I are both very excited, frankly, about what's happening here. And it's just a fun place to be because everything changes so fast and there's so much to learn. So let me just stop there and I'd be happy to answer any questions.